Wonderful. Welcome, everybody. My name is Cindy. I'm the Executive Director of MoMath. It is my great pleasure to welcome you tonight to another edition of Math Encounters. And our gratitude goes out to the Simons Foundation, whose generous support makes it possible for us to continue this series and continue bringing you wonderful mathematical presentations month after month after month. But with that, let me turn it over to Amy Wilkinson. Amy is a math enthusiast and a professor of mathematics at the University of Chicago, and we are delighted she's here today to kick off tonight's program. Please join me in welcoming Amy.
Thank you, Cindy. It's a pleasure to be here. And it's also a great pleasure to introduce Diana Davis. So Diana Davis completed her PhD at Brown University in 2013 under the direction of Richard Schwartz. She was a postdoc at Northwestern University near Chicago for 3 years, followed by visiting professorships at Williams College and Swarthmore College. Dr. Davis has published over a dozen papers, mostly on aspects of mathematical billiards and dynamical systems, and has given over 100 talks in 22 states and 9 countries. Davis is also an educational innovator, created the teaching problem-centered discussion-based math courses of all levels and studying their pedagogical effectiveness. Outside of research and teaching, she enjoys long-distance running, which she's very good at, recreational sailing, which she might also be really good about, but I know about the running, traveling, and thinking about how to build community and create a sustainable world. I first met Diana right after she got her PhD when she came to Northwestern. I'm in the Chicago area. And we invited Dr. Davis to come give a talk about her work in our seminar at the University of Chicago. And about 3/4 of the way through her talk, she pulled out a video, and it was a dance video. So Dr. Davis won a contest, an international contest called Dance Your Dissertation, and open to people in all fields. And she'll show you some bits from this video tonight. It was probably the first time I've ever seen dance as part of a talk in the dynamics seminar at the University of Chicago, and it was both delightful and incredibly deep, actually. So Dr. Davis works in dynamical systems, which is the study of motion, and is also the field that I study. She works in a specific subfield of dynamical systems, which is the study of billiards. What is a billiard table? It's just like a pool table, except there's no pockets, no holes in the corners. And playing billiards is exactly what you think it is. You put a ball, which is a tiny, well, infinitesimal point in your billiard table, and you shoot it off in a direction and it bounces off the sides, and you ask, well, what happens in the long term? So the study of billiards goes back a long ways. I think they might have been first introduced to model problems in physics, such as the study of ideal gases in a box. These were introduced by Fina to model Boltzmann's ideal gases. But they've also been used more recently to try to understand structures on surfaces. And this is what Dr. Davis will tell you about. I'm going to give you one open problem in billiards, which is take a billiard table that is a triangle. And question, when does that triangular billiard table have what's called a periodic orbit? And what that means, and Dr. Davis will tell you more about this, is under what conditions can you start with a ball somewhere on the edge of the table, not in the corners, shoot it off at some angle, have it bounce around a bunch of times, and come back exactly to where it started and in exactly the same angle, and then do the same thing over and over again. That is unknown as a general problem for triangles. It's unknown for obtuse triangles. Dr. Davis's advisor, Rich Schwartz, made a very important breakthrough in answering this question for tables where the largest angle is in a certain range of angles. But as a general question, it's still open. So you can think about that while you hear Dr. Davis talk about the regular polygon tables, such as the pentagons that are right behind her. And I guarantee you this talk will be a lot of fun. So please join me in welcoming Diana Davis. Thanks.
All right. Thank you, everyone. Thank you so much, Amy, for being here and for giving that wonderful introduction and for inviting me to come to the University of Chicago so long ago. It was wonderful. Great. So let's begin. So let's talk about billiards. I'm going to talk about billiards. Well, my favorite shape is the regular pentagon, as you can see behind me. But also we're going to start with the square and talk about the regular pentagon and then move on to more polygons like these here. Okay, so billiards, as Amy described, is just a particle bouncing around inside a polygon. It could be a square, could be a regular pentagon, could be really any shape. I'm going to be focusing on the regular pentagon and then other regular polygons with an odd number of sides. And you might ask, like, why are you studying the regular pentagon? Well, it's because it's kind of the first interesting example. So as humans, we understand the square, which is just like a rectangular pool table, except with no pockets. You get to keep the ball forever. The equilateral triangle and the regular hexagon. What's nice about these is if you think about it, if you reflect them across their edges and sort of unfold them, they tile the plane like that. And so that makes things kind of easy in a way that we'll see. But the regular pentagon famously doesn't tile the plane. And so it's sort of the first interesting example of a shape that you have to use some other method on. Now, Amy mentioned that it's an open question whether every triangular billiard table has a periodic trajectory. For regular polygons, it's not open. You can see that if you just take the midpoint of one edge and the midpoint of any other edge, and you make a billiard path that goes from one midpoint to another, you'll always get a periodic trajectory in any of these polygons. So I'll be talking a lot about the square and the pentagon, and then a little bit about these other shapes with an odd number of sides that are regular polygons. So billiards is, in mathematical billiards, unlike in real life, when you shoot your ball and it hits the side, the angle of incidence and the angle of reflection are always equal. So that's what we'll assume. If you do it in real life, there might be spin or friction or something, but no, we do not care about these things. We are mathematicians. Okay, so I really care about periodic paths. So it's an open question for the triangle, but I just want to understand all of them. It's an open question as to whether one even exists for some triangles, but I want to understand all of the periodic trajectories for these shapes that I'm studying. So let's talk about the square. So in the square, a periodic trajectory is one that just goes out and comes back to where it starts. So here's a simple one. I call that period two because it's two bounces before it repeats. Here's one. I call it period four because it bounces four times and then it repeats. And then here you might not have thought of this one, but it has period six, bounces around six times and then comes back to where it starts. So you might wonder, okay, there's three examples, but what are all the directions I can hit my ball in so that it will repeat and be periodic? It's a great question. So let's think about some ways. You could think about it for a while, and if you thought about it for a very long time, you might have this clever idea. So here, this trajectory is bouncing around, and it's going in all these different directions. There's these four different directions that I've labeled here with arrows, and that's a little complicated. So to simplify my life, when it hits the side here, instead of bouncing off, I'm going to create a new copy of the table so that it can just go straight through. And then when it bounces off this green side, I'm just going to create a new copy so it can go through. And then when it bounces off this red side, I'll create a new copy and so on. And we could keep doing this, just creating a new copy of the square every time we needed one. And so you can see that a billiard trajectory on the square is equivalent to just a line through a piece of graph paper. And because we're unfolding over the edges like this, you can see why it might be easier to study the square and the equilateral triangle and the regular hexagon and other shapes that tile the plane by reflection in their edges.
So that's one thing we could do. We could just draw a line across a piece of graph paper and study that. But one thing you could notice is that this square up here, which has yellow at the top off the screen, exactly fits into here. So we can take this square with its tiny little bit of trajectory here that we have, and we can move it down and place it here. So now our billiard path, instead of bouncing, it just goes through. And instead of going through this red edge, it comes back to the bottom. And when it hits this blue edge on the side, we'll just have a new copy over here and it'll keep going this way. So this is a surface called the square torus. And you might wonder, what do you mean it's a surface? It's just a square with some sort of funny rules that when you come off one side, you reappear on the other side. But let me tell you how to build a torus. So the top and the bottom are glued together because when our path hit the top, it reappeared on the bottom. And the same with the left and the right. So it's kind of like this. Well, it's very much like this. You've got this square and it's got red at the top and blue on the sides. And we want to glue the red and the red because they're the same. Well, that's easy. We just stick them together like this. And I've got it in my hand and I'll also do it on the screen. We stick them together like that. And now the blue, just like the red was glued together, the blue is glued together, these ends. Well, I can't do it with my handy cardboard tube, but I can do it if it was infinitely stretchable. So I would make it long and then I'd spring it over and then whoosh, bring this around. And I'd get a surface, the surface of a donut or a bagel or what mathematicians call a torus. So we're actually on a surface. Instead of studying billiards on a square table, we can study straight lines on this torus surface. Now I'll tell you one piece of terminology. We say that this surface has genus one. Genus means the number of holes. Genus one means one hole. And when we use a program later, in the very end, I'll be plugging in the genus into the surface, into the computer. So you can remember it just means a number of holes. Okay, so a question is, if you have a square billiard table and you are going to hit your ball like this, I don't know, somehow there. If you're going to hit your ball with your pool cue, you want to know what's going to happen. Like what happens if I just push it in this direction and then let it bounce around? Well, that's a great question. This particular direction that I chose has slope 3/5. So what does slope mean? You might remember slope just means the rise over the run. So this one has a slope 3/5, meaning that it rises 3 times and runs 5 times. So I've shown how this billiard trajectory bounces around. It bounces, 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 bounces. And we can see where it hits the sides. So because the slope is 3/5, it rises 3 times, it's gonna hit the top 3 times. And because the run is 5, it's gonna hit the right side 5 times. And the same, it'll hit the bottom 3 times also and this other side 5 times. So we can figure out that if our slope is 3/5, okay, it hits the sides this number of times. And we could generalize if the slope is any kind of rational number, any kind of number that can be expressed as a fraction, we get a periodic path. So whatever is at the top of the fraction is the number of times it hits the top. Whatever is the bottom of the fraction is the number of times it hit the sides. So if you want periodic trajectories, which we do, you want fractions as your slope. So we love fractions. So let's talk a little bit of, let's like write this down. If you hit a trajectory or a billiard path with a rational slope, P over Q, where P and Q are whole numbers, you'll get a periodic trajectory. It'll have period 2 times T+Q because it hits the top and the bottom each P times, and then it hits each of the sides Q times. So that's how many times it'll bounce. But what if it's not rational? What if the slope is some irrational number like E or pi or the square root of 5? Well, you can think of an irrational number as just the limit of rational numbers where the top and the bottom get bigger and bigger and bigger. And so you can think about that it would just hit the top of the square more and more times, and it would hit the side of the square more and more times. And actually, if you let it go forever, it would look like this. So much of the work on billiards has focused on these non-repeating trajectories. But I like these periodic trajectories because they make nice pictures, which I can make into jewelry which is like what I'm wearing, or anyway, you can see the picture of what the trajectory looks like. It's not just a black square. And when I draw a black square, the first time I drew this picture, it was sort of a joke, but really is like a black square, because the theorem is that regular polygons, like the square, the regular pentagon or anything like that, exhibit what's called optimal dynamics. Every trajectory, meaning no matter how you hit the ball, is either periodic or equidistributed. And what equidistributed means is it's gonna visit all the parts of the table the same amount. It's not gonna just like hang out at this corner more than it hangs out at that corner. It's just gonna be even across the whole thing. So those are your only options, periodic or equidistributed. Okay, so here's a question for you. Two questions. First question is, what do you think is more likely if you just hit your ball in some direction? Do you think it's more likely to be periodic or equidistributed? You can put it in the chat or you can sing out. Probably better to put it in the chat. Let's see, equidistributed, irrational, equidistributed. Someone says periodic, equidistributed. Okay, I think equidistributed is winning. Oh, but there's some votes for periodic. Well, it turns out it's equidistributed because a number, if you just randomly pick a number, it's gonna be irrational with probability 1 or 100%. So periodic trajectories and rational numbers are rare, but they're beautiful. So I like to study them. Okay, question number 2. This is a poll question. How many people are watching this with you, including yourself? So we're taking a poll to see how many people are here, trying to beat the all-time attendance record. Amy mentioned that I'm a competitive long-distance runner. She didn't mention that I'm also competitive at everything else in life. So I want to have the most people ever, include your cat. Just kidding. Only if your cat is paying very close attention. Okay, so here we go. That's what we know about regular polygons. Okay, so I want to tell you about something really, really nice, the Euclidean algorithm. And actually what I'm going to do is I'm going to tell you about it in 3 different ways. So there are different kinds of mathematicians. I'm going to group them into 2 kinds, algebraists and geometers. Some people like thinking about things algebraically and some people like things geometrically, and I am a geometer. But I'll start with the algebraic way of thinking about the Euclidean algorithm. Okay, so here's what it is. Here's why you would use it. Suppose you have 2 numbers like 7 and 5, and you want to find their greatest common divisor. So the biggest number that fits evenly into 7 and 5. Well, maybe you can see that that number would be 1, but we're doing a simple example so that we can sort of see what's going on. So what we do, here's the algorithm. You take the smaller one and you subtract it from the larger one repeatedly until the 2 numbers match. And when they match, that number, that matching number, is the greatest common divisor. So let's start with 7 and 5. 5 is smaller, we subtract it, we get 2. Now 2 is smaller, we subtract it, we get 3. 2 is still smaller, we subtract it again, we get 1. Now 1 is smaller, we subtract it, and we get 1 and 1. So now the numbers match, and that tells us that the greatest common divisor of 7 and 5 is 1. Now, so that's the Euclidean algorithm, and it comes up a lot. Like if you want to reduce a fraction, if you want to get a fraction in lowest terms, you want to divide out by the greatest common divisor of top and bottom. So it comes up. And one reason people like it is because it's super fast to compute. You can compute it recursively and it's like almost instant. So people like it. Okay. So how about another thing? So I'm a geometer, and this is how I like to think about the continued fraction, about this algorithm. I like to think about it as continued fractions with a rectangle. So it's kind of different. Okay. So continued fractions are a really cool thing that doesn't seem to be in any kind of curriculum. Sometimes you might learn about it if you go to a talk or something. So today's your day. You're at this talk and you're learning about continued fractions. So here's what it's good for. Here's a rectangle. Let's suppose we want to know the aspect ratio of this rectangle. So it's not a square. I can tell it's a little bit wider than it is tall, but I don't think it's like twice as wide as it is tall, a little less than that, maybe like around 1.5. So I'd love to have a better approximation, a better guess for this aspect ratio, 1.5. Okay, so here's what you do. You start with the rectangle whose aspect ratio you want, and you repeatedly cut off the largest possible square. So for instance, first the largest possible square is this one, and then you keep track of how many you cut off at each step. So I cut off 1, and that's all I could do. So now instead of going across, I'm gonna switch to going up and down. So I'm going to cut off as many squares as I can in this direction. It was 2. And I did 1 over because I switched from going horizontally to going vertically. So I did a 1 over. Okay, and now I'm going to switch to horizontally again. And how many squares can fit in the top? 2. And it's exactly. So we're done. And I did a 1 over and I got 2. Okay, so I kept track. There was 1 of the big ones, 2 of the medium ones, 2 of the small ones, and my continued fraction. And if you want, you can reduce this fraction with your paper, with your pen, and you get that it is 7 over 5. So 7 over 5 is 1.4. Seems reasonable. I estimated about 1.5. It's pretty good. Okay, so that's the continued fraction algorithm. And this is what a continued fraction is. It's always a number plus 1 over, some number plus 1 over, some number plus 1 over, and you can go as long as you want. Sometimes infinitely long, if you're into that sort of thing. Okay, so let's run all of these algorithms backwards. So up here, I've got my 1 and my 1. I suppose I just want to start with 2 numbers whose GCD is 1. For my rectangles, I start with this little square because it's the smallest square. And for my continued fraction, I just start with a 1 because there's 1 square. Okay, and then we go forward. We say, okay, let's just add them together. Let's add them together. And I'll put 1 square. And over here, I say I have 2 of them now. And I'm like, okay, that's enough. Let's switch to the other way. So we put our squares vertically now, and we put 1 over in our continued fraction, and we're gonna switch to adding with the 1. So there we go. We've switched to adding with the 3. We're going down, adding down here now. We've added a square, and over here, we put a 1 on the front. That's this one here, yeah. And let's do another one. Okay, so we do the same thing in all the places. We add another one down here, add another square, add and get the 5. Let's say we're done. So we're going to switch directions. So I do a 1 over my continued fraction, and I flip those, and I'm going to add at the top, and I add 1 more. So it's all the same thing. Whether we are going down, over, whether we're taking a 1 over and adding 1s, whether we're adding to the other side, it's sort of all the same thing, thought of differently. The takeaway message is that at each step we choose, and especially in this thing up here, if we think of this top one as the x value and this bottom one as the y value, at each step we're choosing to increase either the x value, or that's the blue one, or the y value, that's the red one. And at every step we have 2 choices. So we can make a binary tree of all possible outcomes of this process and see all the possible numbers we can get, pairs of numbers that we can get. And what we get is all the relatively prime pairs of numbers. And what relatively prime means, it just means 2 numbers whose greatest common divisor is 1. So we're never gonna get something like 8 and 4 here because we started with GCD of 1. So we're gonna get all the relatively prime pairs, numbers that don't have any divisors other than 1, any common divisors. Okay, so being a geometer, I'm not content with just 1 geometric way of showing this to you. We're gonna do something even more geometric. So use a shear. So what's a shear? It's like you take something and you go, whoosh. So the bottom goes one way, the top goes the other way. And I only have my 2 hands here, but the further up you are, the further over you go. So if my arm stays constant in this shear, if I'm up here, I'm gonna get pushed to the side. If I'm up here, I'm gonna get way pushed to the side. And if I'm up here, I'm gonna get way pushed to the side. And the same thing down here, I'm gonna get pushed over by various amounts, depending on how far down I am. So it just pushes everything over. That's a shear, that's a horizontal shear that I was doing, and you can do it in any direction. So here's what we're gonna do. We're gonna take this rectangle here, or what you could call the first quadrant, and we're gonna do a horizontal shear, which pushes the whole thing over and makes it into the blue area. We're also going to take a vertical shear, which takes the whole thing and pushes it up into the red area. And for those who are so inclined, we're taking these black vectors here and turning them into the red vectors and the blue vectors respectively, which use these matrices to do it if you are linear algebraically inclined. And there's lots of ways you could do it, and we choose the one with determinant 1 so that it preserves area. Okay, but I just think about it geometrically. So what do? We start with 1.01, and we apply both shears. So we take it and we push everything to the side, and we push everything up. And it turns out for the first step, we only just get this 1 point. And then we do it again. We apply our 2 shears to this point, and we get this new point from the horizontal shear, and this new point from the vertical shear. And then we do it again. And this one gives us this new point from the horizontal shear and this one from the vertical shear and so on. And you can see that this one is only a distance one up, so it gets pushed over by one. And this one's a distance two up, so it gets pushed over by two and so on. And then we take all of our new points. This is like our binary. We're just like running our Euclidean algorithm or our continued fraction algorithm backwards. What do we get this time? We get these eight new things. And then if we apply them both to those, we get these 16 new things. Okay, so we're getting all these points. I'm not gonna do it forever, but you could do this forever. And what do you get? Well, you get every relatively prime pair of numbers. So every number, every pair whose greatest common divisor is one. So I'd like to think of that as visible lattice points. So you can imagine that all these points, the black ones and the green ones, and all the rest of them that we haven't drawn on the screen, are trees. And you, like Maria Mirzakhani here, are sitting at the origin, looking out, and you want to know which trees you can see. And you can exactly see these. So for example, you can see the tree at 2, 1, because there's nothing between it, but you can't see the one at 4, 2 here because it's blocked by 2, 1. And that's because 4, 2 have a common divisor. We don't like those. We want ones with greatest common divisor one. So what this does is it gives us all the directions. And what these are our lowest terms periodic directions. So like we had our slope 3/5 in our billiard table, 3, 5 is in this picture. It's right here. It's a periodic direction. So we know that if we hit our billiard ball from the origin toward this point, we're going to get a periodic direction. And that's what we get here is all the periodic directions. It also, it's a tree, it gives us a tree structure. I'll draw some trees, but a tree structure just means you have one thing coming in and several things coming out. And you can see like this one, blue coming in and then both options coming out. It's a binary tree. At every point you have two decisions to make. And also it gives every visible point a location in the tree. So like this one, 7, 5, our favorite, there's just one way to get there. You had to do the red choice, then the blue choice, then the red choice, then the red choice, then the blue choice to get there. So there's a unique way to get there. And it gives it a kind of a zip code, what I call a tree location, but it's kind of like a zip code. It tells you how to get there. And we'll use those a lot later. There'll be ones like 102 coming up in our future that we love very much. And that just means that we used these things to get there. So here's the tree. I've been talking about this as a tree, but I now am drawing it as a tree. We start out with 10, we get 11, and then from each point on, every point gives us two more points. Every point gives us two more points. And so every rational pair, every rational number like 3/5, or every relatively prime pair like 3 and 5, like this one, appears somewhere in this tree. So the 7/5 that we were talking about at the beginning appears here at the fourth level of the tree. So it's kind of a measure of how complicated a thing is, how far out it appears in the tree. But every pair of rational numbers or every rational number will appear here as a pair. Okay, so now we know all our rational numbers, which we like. You might wonder, okay, what do billiards on the square look like? I mean, we've seen this one example, slope 3/5. Guess 3 bounces on the top, 5 bounces on the sides. What about other trajectories? So here's one. I think this was slope 7/5. You can see it hits at the top 7 times, side 5 times. Here's some other one. Here's some other one. Here's some other one. Okay, so I could show you more, but actually there's not much to show you. One thing is that the slope determines the path. Certainly when I hit the ball at slope 3/5, I know it's gonna happen. But the menagerie of things that I get is not varied very much. So periodic billiards on the square always look kind of like a chain link fence, a bunch of rhombuses and parallelograms and then triangles up the sides. So there's not that much to see. Okay, how about pentagons? So let's do some of these. So I prepared a handout, which you may have seen. Yep. Let me put that in the chat. Thank you. Somebody put it in. Awesome. And so I'll just show it on the screen. Let's do it. So we have a math student who's hitting the ball in the direction of the arrow. Can you connect the dots to show the ball's path? This is Zoom, so we can annotate. You can grab that annotation tool and connect the dots. Let's do it. Oh, Nathan is showing. You've done it there, Nathan. Nice job. I see. Great job. Came prepared. Thank you. There it is. Nice. Okay, beautiful. So this is like a canonical basic trajectory on the regular pentagon. Very nice, everyone. Okay, I am going to make it go away because we have another one to do. Oops, how about this one? So again, we connect the dots. Ah, nice job, Nathan's looking good. And while someone is connecting it, here you can address this question. Why does the, we're going across. There's no going across. Oh, this one's funny. Okay. Why does the ball bounce twice in the same spot? 1 and 3 are both in the same spot. Anybody have any ideas? Ah, it's perpendicular to the side, reflection symmetry. Yes, exactly. It's a right angle. Yes, very good. Oops. Something strange happens. Let's go back. Okay. Yes, exactly. This is a right angle. And so when it bounces off, it comes back exactly the way that it came. Pretty cool. Like often when you throw a ball against the wall, you throw it perpendicularly because you expect to have it come back into your hand. So this is a normal thing we have in our life. Okay. How about this one? Oh my gosh. I think we might need a collaboration here. Either that or someone else can draw it there. 1, then it goes to 2. Okay. 3, then it goes to 4. There it goes. Wow, billiard trajectory is really getting filled out here. It might seem a little bit randomish at the beginning, but you'll see that it gets a nice shape here after a little while. Yeah, there it is. Okay, so you can see the period is 20 because it comes back at number 20. And wow, that is beautiful. That is really nice. Then the question I put on here is, can you find a pattern to the ball's bounces? Any ideas about that? Is there a pattern? Yeah, it repeats its position every 10 steps. It does repeat its position. It's sort of like every 4 steps. Let's see. I can have the biggest arrow. We say we go to 1, and then we go to 2, and then we go to 3, and then we go to 4. And I think this little motif that I've just drawn, it just repeats itself over and over again. In fact, it repeats itself 5 times. And that's how we get that 20, period 20. Repeats from center to near a corner. Yeah, alternates the small angle and the larger angle. Yeah, exactly. We have that big bounce along the edge and then that angle bounce to the opposite side. Yeah, beautiful. Okay, sorry everyone, there it goes. And then, how about this one? Can you follow it around and number what number you hit? Nice job, you're holding it up, I love it. The trajectory is already written, but you've got to number them, see what order they go in. 2, okay. 3, 4. Oh, someone's typing, so nice. Brilliant. Yeah, so this we never came up with this one. It looks like what, period 10? We didn't come up, like the star we knew about before we programmed our computer, but this one we had never imagined before. I like to call it the spaceship. Yeah, it's interesting that it bounces twice in the middle of a side. That turns out to be always the case. If the ball bounces in the middle of a side, it always does it twice. So we saw that in the other one where it had the wide bounce and the skinny bounce on each middle. And the same thing happens here, a wide and a skinny. Okay, wonderful. Thanks everyone. Okay, so what happens now? Well, you might remember that when we were studying the square, we used the surface of a torus. So I made it with this little thingy here. You might wonder, what about for the pentagon? Do we have a surface? Well, we do. We have a surface. And to explain it to you, I'm going to show you this video. As Professor Wilkinson mentioned, I now show this video instead of like saying stuff because it shows it better. So here we go. This is the surface associated to the Pentagon billiard table. So if you are a Harry Potter book aficionado, you can imagine that Libby here is going through the wall in the train station to end up at school. But just like before, where we had the red and the blue edges of our square, and you go across one and end up back in the square on the other side, here, Libby goes across the yellow edge and ends up back in the other pentagon. So instead of using just one square with the sides identified, we use these two pentagons with all five pairs of sides identified, including that black side in the middle. Okay. Good. All right. So now we will talk about the pentagon. Here we go. Just be 1 second because it has to load all the beautiful pictures for the end. So we want to use this surface. Usually it turns out when people study billiards, what they really study is the associated surfaces. So if you say, I study billiards, if someone says to you, I study billiards, what they really mean is that they study surfaces associated to billiards. Sometimes people actually get so caught up in their surfaces that they forget about the billiards, but I have not made this mistake. I go right back to billiards, although my first couple of papers were just about surfaces. Okay, so I showed you the double pentagon in the video. We had Libby dancing around on it. The double pentagon surface has a friend called the golden L. And this is a surface just like the other one. If you went up across the orange side, you'd reappear on this orange side. If you went up across this blue side, appear on a blue side, and so on. And this surface is made of two overlapping rectangles. So the rectangle here and then an identical rectangle here. And when they overlap, of course, you get a square. But these aren't just any rectangles. These are golden rectangles. So they're in a ratio. One side is one and one side is what's called the golden ratio, which is 1 + √5 all over 2, or approximately 1.618. And this number is, people just like rectangles like this. You'll notice that if you have a driver's license or a business card, they're often in a ratio very similar to this. And there's lore that like our hands are in this ratio, or that our head to our belly button and our belly button to the floor is in this ratio. Let's see, I found this cute thing. Nope, that wasn't the one. About the average woman and Barbie, that arguably you can say all these funny things about your hand being in this ratio, but Barbie is actually literally in this ratio apparently. That's kind of cool. Anyway, what we like about it in math is that it has this wonderful property. Let's see. It has this property, actually, and I have one right here. So it has this property that if you take a rectangle in this proportion and you cut off this square, the rectangle that's left is in the same proportion as the original. And that turns out to make things really beautiful and easy. And it makes math work out great, and it just makes things beautiful, it turns out. Okay, so I think I said that the double pentagon and the golden L are friends. And what I mean is they're actually kind of the same. Sometimes you like to have friends that are really similar to you, and sometimes you like to have friends that are different. Pentagon and the golden L are in the first category. So they really are very similar. And what you can do is you can take this picture. I don't know if I'm gonna be able to do this. This is too difficult. Okay, take this picture and you shear it up and you get the other picture. So you have to take this thing in your mind, the picture on the left, take it in your mind and shear it upwards, shear it upwards, and you get the picture on the right. Or you take the picture on the right and you shear it downwards and you get the picture on the left. And you might notice that there's like some pieces sticking out of this one. But remember that this side of this pentagon is glued to this side. And so you can just reassemble like this and get the other surface. And if you're wondering, well, where did the golden ratio come from? Like this rectangle here, why is it in the golden rectangle? Why is it a golden rectangle? Well, it's because if you have a regular pentagon where one of the sides is one, then the diagonal has length golden ratio. That's how it works out. You can just measure it. It's what it is. And when we shear it over to here, well, everything gets smaller by a factor of 1/φ. Yep, 1 plus square root of 5/2 is a golden ratio. And so when this phi scales down to 1, this one scales down to 1/φ. And so this little rectangle here is in the same proportion as the original because it's 1/1/φ, same as phi to 1. So that's where it comes from. So what happens now? Now, I tell you why am I using the golden L? Well, I was studying the double pentagon for my PhD thesis. That's why I made that video. It was all about my PhD thesis on the double pentagon. And that was in fall 2012 that I made that video, or spring, summer 2012. And then in spring of 2014, I went to a conference in Germany and I met this guy, Samuel Lelievre, and he came up to me and he said, I loved your video. I work on the golden L. And since the golden L and the double pentagon, well, they're so similar, we decided to work together because we could take my expertise on the double pentagon and his expertise on the golden L and put them together and actually understand billiards on the regular pentagon. So we've been working on that ever since. Okay, so here's the approach. So one way you can think about a rational number is that it's like a fraction over a fraction, or a rational slope is like rise over run. Is a fraction over a fraction. But another way you can do it is sort of scale it up and just say rational slope is any direction connecting corners in the square grid. So this is 3/5. Any direction connecting corners in the square grid is going to give you a rational slope or a periodic direction in the billiard table. So we do the same thing for the golden L, except instead of unfolding squares, we unfold golden L's. So when you pass across a side, you put either a little rectangle, or a square there, depending on where you are on the table. And we just want directions that connect corners of golden L's, unfolded in this manner. Okay, so what's the game? Now, a few minutes ago, I told you all about the Euclidean algorithm starting with two numbers, that you can start with 1 and 1, and you can get any reduced fraction that you want. And I also showed you how to do it with shears in the first quadrant. So the reason we did that so much is so that when I get to this part, I can say it's basically the same. And I'm going to say it's basically the same for the golden L. But instead of chopping this first quadrant into two pieces, we're chopping it into four pieces. So we have these four, instead of having just the horizontal shear and the vertical shear like the last time, we now have these four. So we have the horizontal shear, the vertical shear, and then these other two, this green and this yellow, that take the whole first quadrant to just these very small pieces. And these are, if you like linear algebra, these are the matrices that do the job, again, chosen so the determinant is 1 so that they preserve area. Okay, so what do we do? Well, we want all of the periodic directions in the golden L. And so we're just going to start with our simplest direction, which is this one. And we're going to apply these four shears and just see all the different like relatively prime points that we get. So I start with this point. I apply those three shears. I get these three points. And now I'm going to apply the three shears to the green point. And I get these three new points. Apply it to the yellow point. I get these three new points and apply it to the red point. Or I get these four new points, right? In this case, we get four new points. And then from each of those, we get four. And then from each of those, we get four. And from each of those, we get four. And we just get this huge tree of points. Last time it was a binary tree because at every point we had two choices of where to go. Here it's what's called a quaternary tree. At every point we have four choices of places to go. So gosh, that looks like a mess. But that gives us all the periodic directions. And I can just make that tree a little bit more tidy for you. So we started with this one. We applied our shears and got three new points. And then from each of those, we apply our shears and get four new points. And then the tree would just keep going. But after this, it's got too many pieces to show on the screen. 48 things in the next generation. Too many. And all along, we have been asking about pentagon billiard trajectories. So here are the corresponding pentagon billiard trajectories. At the top is the pentagon, which is associated to the star that we drew in the first exercise on that we were annotating together. And then on this first level, first interesting level or whatever, non-trivial level of the tree, are those paths that we drew a little bit later in our annotation together. So you can see all these things, and I've written under each one the tree location. So for instance, to get this nice star, sea star looking picture here, you do two and then you do three, and that's how you get there. So that's like its zip code, that two and that three. Okay. So now I'm gonna tell you about a whole bunch of things that don't happen on the square, that happen on other polygons. And this sort of thing, people had never seen these pictures before. So up until March, so Samuel and I met in 2014 and we started working on things and we made a program that draws pentagon billiard trajectories, like all the beautiful ones you saw at the beginning of my talk. And then for spring break this past year, 2020, I went to France to a math institute and was fortunate to get stuck there due to the pandemic. And so while we were in confinement, we were actually in lockdown in France. We were far, 3 kilometers apart, but we couldn't talk to each other. But we programmed many more. We made our program so it can draw billiard trajectories on any regular polygon with an odd number of sides. So I'm gonna show you about the beautiful things that happen for polygons with an odd number of sides that don't happen on the square. Symmetry, buddies, and families. Okay, let's talk about symmetry. So trajectories have different symmetries. You might have noticed this. Some of them have only reflection symmetry, and some of them have both reflection and rotation symmetry. And it turns out that the orders of the rotations are divisors of the number of sides. And when I say order of rotation, I just mean like you can do a small turn that preserves the thing, and the order of the rotation is how many times you have to repeat that small turn in order to get back to where you started. So you can see that this one has threefold symmetry. This one, it might be hard to tell, but it has ninefold symmetry, same as the polygon. And then this one, well, it doesn't have any kind of rotation symmetry. So we say it has order one, because you just have to do it all the way around to get back to where you started. But you can see it has reflection symmetry. And that's kind of a fun thing to do, is to look at a trajectory that doesn't have, that only has reflection symmetry, and see where the line of reflection is. So that's nine. How about something else? So I have found by showing these to lots of people that there are two kinds of people. People who like trajectories with rotation symmetry, and those who like it better without. So here's a gallery of paths with only reflection symmetry on the regular 15-gon. I started exploring the regular 15-gon for my niece's 15th birthday. Pretty nice, huh? I mean, you'd never think of these if you were just noodling around with a pencil. Look at those beautiful strips. And as I said, it's kind of fun to look for the axis of symmetry. Look at that, huh? It even looks like there's sort of a curve. I don't know. You see the curve? You see the curve. It's there. There's the curve. Yeah. Okay. How about buddies? It's good to have a buddy. In a pandemic, sometimes you don't get to have all the buddies that you want, but pentagon trajectories always have buddies, and regular polygons even have more than one buddy usually. So buddies are the parallel trajectories in a given direction. So basically, you've made a decision. You've decided that you're gonna hit your ball in this direction, but you haven't decided whether you're gonna stand here, or maybe you're gonna stand here, or here, or maybe you're gonna stand here. It's like all the different, you've picked a direction, but you haven't decided your location yet, your starting location. And having different starting locations gives me what I call buddies. So for instance, if we start with the pentagon, my old favorite, if you've decided you're going to hit your trajectory horizontal, if you hit it anywhere up here horizontally, you'll get this pentagon-shaped trajectory. But if you hit it anywhere down at the bottom horizontally, you'll get this star-shaped trajectory. So I call those buddies, horizontal buddies. Let's try more intricate ones. So here's the 15-gon. Again, you've made a decision that you're going to hit your trajectory horizontally, but you haven't decided. Are you going to hit it at the top, or maybe a little further down, or a little further down? And so this gives you, this is all the options of the beautiful trajectories you get. And you might notice that they have different symmetries. So they have symmetries of, in this case, order 3, 5, and 15. And those are the divisors of 15. We could have gotten something without rotation symmetry with just symmetry 1, but we didn't. Oh, well. How about 27? So I like polygons that are not prime numbers of sides because they have the chance of having things with interesting symmetries. And look at how interesting these symmetries are. So again, I've chosen a direction. It's that one that I've highlighted in all of these. Look at that. Is that so cool or what, huh? Sort of like maybe like a dream catcher or something. I'm not sure what you would call it. But you can see these have all different symmetries. In this case, symmetries of order 1, 3, and 9. I think I put that there's 27, but I'm not seeing a 27. But they're divisors of 27. Like you can look at what, like this one almost looks like a hexagon, like it would have symmetry of order 6, but no, you can kind of see it's only order 3. Kind of cool. So the takeaway message is that the direction controls the behavior. So once you, like which direction you're going to hit your ball in is the most important thing to decide. But once you decide that, and that's coded by that location in the tree, in a given direction, there are several different buddies. So for the 27 gone, there are 13 different buddies. It's the number of sides minus 1, that whole thing divided by 2. And it's actually the genus of the surface gives you the different buddies. So there are several different, but in any case, there are several different buddies in a given direction. So the last thing I'd like to talk about is families. This one I discovered by chance. So when Samuel and I made this program, just these pentagon trajectories are beautiful and nobody had ever seen them before in the history of the world. So I wanted to share them with people and not just like math people by giving talks. I wanted to share them with everyone. And so I wanted to make jewelry. So you'll see I am currently wearing jewelry, and some of you who are here in the talk have this jewelry. Perhaps you are wearing it. But you may have gathered from what I said that there are countably infinitely many different periodic trajectories on the pentagon. And I didn't want to have countably infinite inventory. I wanted to just decide which were the most beautiful trajectories. So I sent out this, I made this into a webpage and I sent it to my friends and I said, tell me which one you like the best and I'll make it into earrings for you. So they did, and I sent them earrings. And then another thing that I did was I just made a box of 10 that I thought were nice, and I made them into earrings. And then I would carry them around to talks and all sorts of things, give them out to people on the airplane, all sorts of things. And I'd say, yeah, take whichever one you want. So I have a question for you, a real question. Suppose this was in front of you, this box. And I said, yeah, pick whichever one you want. Now they're the same in columns, so pick your favorite column. Which column is your favorite? I guess you can annotate. There's an oval tool. They're all so beautiful, but no one is annotating. Oh, can we not annotate? Oh, we can't annotate. That's right, we can't annotate because this is a screen. Okay, but you can say in the chat which one is your favorite. Sorry about that. I see. You're already doing it. You're so smart. And what turned out to happen is that this one was a clear favorite. Like people like this one. And it's hard to take a poll in the chat. But it happened to me more than once that I've given a talk this and I've showed this picture to an auditorium of people and I say, how many people pick this one? And like two-thirds of the people, three-quarters of the people in the room raise their hand. Sometimes it happens and sometimes it doesn't. But this was a clear favorite. People were always picking this one. Like I'd walk around to this little box and this column would be empty. And what happened was people out of the little box, they'd pick this one. And then when I sent people this website, they'd pick this one. And I think it's like a resolution thing. That when the resolution was higher, they liked this more intricate one. And when the resolution was the width of the laser cutter that I used to make the earrings, they picked this one. And I noticed that these were actually pretty similar. I was like, how do I get these? What is going on? What's going on with people? And like, how can I find more of these? So I wanted to make earrings. You know, I'm wearing earrings and a necklace. I thought it would be nice to have this one that people like out of the box as the earring, and this bigger one as the necklace. And then as I scrolled down my webpage, I noticed that there was this more complicated one that was even also similar. And I was like, what is going on? And if you notice, I've labeled them with their location in the tree. So like that zip code. And you can see that there's a similarity between these zip codes. The previous one was 12, this one's 102, and this one's 1002. At the time when we were doing it, we had a slightly different coding, basically, and it obscured this fact. But once we got this good way of keeping track of things, it became pretty clear that the way you get members of this family is by taking 12 and then putting zeros in the middle of it, whatever that means. So cool. So what does this look like? So here's a simple one. So this is the one that we played with at the beginning that we all collaborated to draw this trajectory. And what I'm gonna do is stand here. What I'm gonna do is I'm going to put zeros on the end of this. So trajectory one, trajectory 100, trajectory 1000, and so on. And let's see what we get. We hope they'll be similar looking. Look at that. You see that? You get a star. So cool, a star is born. Okay, let's try that other family. So this one is 12, the one that people like out of the box. 102, 1002, and then we can keep going. Look at that. So I jumped ahead in the process, but look at that. So isn't that beautiful? It's just like, there must be something aesthetically about people that we like things that have this different blend of dark and light somehow. And this, I mentioned in the beginning, you may recall the optimal dynamics that in a regular polygon billiard table, like the regular pentagon or any other one, every trajectory is either periodic or equidistributed. So this one's periodic. Equidistributed means that it visits every part of the table the same amount. And this one so clearly doesn't. If you can't tell, you can take off your glasses and you can just see that the billiard table spends so much more time in the middle than it does in this O shape around the outside. So it's definitely not equidistributed, it's periodic. But I don't think anyone ever imagined that periodic trajectories could do this kind of thing. And it's very rare. That's another thing I want to say, is it's very rare. If you just looked at everything that had, there's just so much out there that we would never have found this phenomenon of these families if I hadn't been doing this jewelry thing and everyone had somehow coalesced on the same choice. Not everyone, 50% of people. It made me sort of obsessed with figuring out what was going on, and then I found these families. So there are also families in other sizes. So this is the regular 51 gun. It looks kind of like a circle, but I promise it has 51 sides. And here's a family. So that's kind of cool. Look at that. If you had a 51 gun table and you hit it in this exact direction, it would not ever get in the middle of the table here, but it would spend a lot of time in this sort of circle around the middle. Pretty cool. How about the 9 gun? Here's a family. Look at that star, huh? That's like a 9 pointed star. That's kind of beautiful. And here's another family in the 9 gun. I think it looks kind of like a shawl. So anyway, we can get lots and lots of different things. One thing I want to make clear is that the world of these things is vast. So when we drew the pentagon trajectories, it was like, okay, regular pentagon. And then it turns out there's two buddies for the regular pentagon. So just draw the two buddies in every direction and go. And we only, I think my webpage goes out to like level 4 in the tree. There's just so much out there to look at. And even if you go further out in the tree, it's very beautiful. Like there's stuff out there you haven't seen yet. And then over spring break last year, we extended our program to regular polygons with any odd number of sides. There's just so much. So here's an example. In the world, if you have too many choices, it's a very good idea to give yourself constraints. So I want to tell you about some constraint project I had. So my niece was turning 15 last year, and I decided for her birthday, I was going to make her a beautiful picture of a trajectory in a regular 15 gun. And in particular, I was going to do the coding as her birthday. So she was born, well, in a month and a day. So like today is February 3rd, so that would be 2/3. So I wanted the coding, like the location in the tree or the zip code to be 2/3. But it could also be like 3/2, because like that's how Europeans do it. And then for every direction, there are some buddies. So I had some options. So here's one option. So this is a 15 gone with her birthday as the direction. Pretty cool. It looks like something very fancy, I think. How about this one? Look at that. That's just, it's just got so many lines in it. And then it's got that cute little sea star in the middle. And then the trajectory never goes to the very middle. Like there's so much going on here. How about this one? Now this is nice. It's got those concentric circles. That's beautiful. I think it would be nice as a tablecloth. Look at that. Now that's got a little star in the middle and then a little pentagon inside the star. I think this one looks a little bit blurry, but if you look carefully, you can see that there it's very precise. There's precise little lines. They're just very close to each other, so it's making it look blurry. Oh, and it has fivefold symmetry. It's a divisor of 15. And then this is the one that I thought was the nicest. It has that beautiful little star in the middle and radiating out and rotational symmetry of order 5. So this is the one that I chose, but the other ones are also really nice and nobody had ever seen them before. So, the world is vast and most people haven't seen any of it, not because it's bad, just because nobody has ever bothered to look at it. So I thought we'd look at CoCalc, which is what we use to code this thing, and we could find some Billiard trajectories that no one has ever seen before. So that's the plan. So if you would, could you please put your favorite numbers in the chat, preferably small numbers and not all prime, because primes are like not that interesting. Good, thank you. Okay, so here is our, here's how we draw these pictures. So sometimes people ask, oh, can I draw some of these pictures myself? Like, do you have a website where you can do it? And we don't, because we do it by like running lines of code. So here's an example of how this works. So the Museum of Mathematics, who's sponsoring this talk, received this provisional charter from New York on 17 November 2009. So it's nice to have constraints. I made this thing have 17 sides by giving it genus 8. Take the genus, double it, and add 1. That's the number of sides. And then I made this word 2009. So what do we get? We get that picture. Yeah, we get that picture. Okay. So what are some good numbers we had here? Oh my goodness. Let's see. Let's find a number with some factors. Well, you said 15. I like that. 4. Okay, we'll have our word be 4 just for fun. And yeah, we can have 15 sides. Somebody asked for that. I like that because it has divisors. And let's see. Let's go and see what we get. So probably what we have seen here, nobody has ever seen before. I have made some kind of mistake. Oh, I don't know. With that. Ah, there we go. Hey, that's pretty cool. Look at that. It's short. It's sweet. Okay, let's try something else. What are some numbers? Okay, we have a 33. Let's try 33 sides. I like 33 that has divisors. Yeah, so this one is 15 sides and we found something with symmetry for order 5, which is kind of cool. That would be 6, genus 16. And what word do we want? Did anyone give us some words? Oh, I don't know. 6 and 4, that's probably fine. It's gonna look weird maybe. Let's see what we get. Okay. What do we get? So whatever we, oh, wow. That is nice. Okay, that is nice. Nobody has ever seen this before. And it is so nice. That looks like a cloud. It looks like looking into heaven or something like that. Okay, let's try something else. We'll just do one more. You all have given me a lot of numbers. It's very hard to decide. I need one of those people who just like
sits around and reads the chat and tells me what to do. Okay, somebody asked for 7 sides, so I'll give this 3. So we have 7 sides. And then, I don't know, what should we use? 2021. Oh, that's nice. 2021. 2021. It's 2021. And that looks good. And let's do it. Someone asked, what app do you use to do this? We wrote this ourselves from scratch. It took a long time. Okay, so this is a good example because this is what most billiard trajectories look like when they get really long. We wrote a thing to automatically make the line width really narrow when the trajectory is really long. So you can kind of see the structure here. But if the line width had been any thicker, this would just look like a black heptagon. So this is what you usually get. This is like kind of close to equidistributed, and this is what you usually get. And so the fact that we got these families of things that are completely not equidistributed is pretty unusual. Now let's see, by the way, if I just change this 2 to a 0, I'm guessing something more interesting will happen. Oh, not really. Let's try a different buddy and see what we can get. If we can get anything better. When the word gets really long, the thing tends to equidistribute. Okay, we're not gonna win this time. So, okay. Okay, but we got some pretty cool ones. Look at that. That's pretty cool, and no one else has ever seen it before in the history of people seeing things. So, okay. Thank you, everyone. Thanks for coming, and it's been great to be with you. So.